Amen, amen. So we've been going through a series called Equipped, and we've been analyzing, looking at the idea that God has called us to do good works on this earth in our lives, and not just kind of in general, like there's not just kind of like a general plan that he has for all people. He has a specific plan for your life, for your geography, for the time period in which you dwell that he wants you to be successful in. And that the Bible actually outlines kind of a series of things that you need to be successful in the mission that God's called you to do. So that's what the kind of the theme has been in this series, and we've been looking at all sorts of different ways that God equips us as the body of Christ, as the family of believers, to do the things that he's called us to do. And today we're going to talk about equipped together, but before I even get there, and I don't normally do this, but sometimes I do this, I'm actually going to show you some science stuff. I'm a mathematician, I'm not a scientist, but I like science stuff because I think science is a means for us to look at the way God's created the world, because he is the author of life, he is the creator, and we can learn things about him as a result. It also talks about that in Romans chapter 1, by the way, if you ever want to read that. So I've got this diagram up here. This is from Douglas Axe's recent book that just came out this month, and he's got kind of a hierarchy, an org chart of the visual system in mammals, okay? So he's got kind of like this idea, so there's the complete visual system. In order for that to function, you've got eyes and the processing system and tear system, optic nerve system, and then he kind of breaks down one of those areas into another series of things, okay? So then, you know, within that there's the retina, within that is the rod cone layer, and then rod cells and outer segment membrane discs, rhodopsin, which is some sort of molecular machine that's encoded within our DNA, that protein is necessary for our eyes to work. From what I understand, locked within that protein is a single molecule of vitamin A, and that's the thing that reacts to light, and depending on how it reacts, that then protein sends the signal back to our brain. Okay, so Douglas Axe is the scientist who's been studying proteins and life for over 20 years, and in his analysis of life, he makes this statement. So I'm going to quote from his book, and he's this guy that a lot of his research has to do with the possibility of whether or not mutations and selection could create new functional proteins, these molecular machines that are within ourselves. Okay, so let's see. I've got this quote up here. So this is what he says. The truth is that living organisms are functionally coherent, meaning from bottom up, every piece is necessary for the entire organism to function. Okay, so like that's the idea, that every little piece, every little component in that org chart we just saw, that was only one kind of branch of that, by the way. And so he says that they're functionally coherent, that everything's working together for the overall goal. In a much more profound sense than human inventions are. He says cars and smartphones and pool robots, the little like cleaning the pool thing, right, are not nearly so unified in their operation. They do fail when a key component fails, but in most cases, the remaining components are unaffected by that failure. The reason for this is that humans don't manufacture all or nothing wholes. Instead, we manufacture things part by part and then assemble the parts into a whole. Each part is made and tested independently according to its own specifications, and indeed, many of these continue to be tested and replaced periodically even after they've been incorporated into a whole. All right, so keep track with me here, all right? You're like, what church did I show up at? I don't know. So he says this, life, as in living organisms, is nothing like that. Somehow, almost unbelievably, living inventions play a key role in building and maintaining themselves, okay? All their parts formed and knitted together in unison within the whole. Life is never anything but whole. So he's got this kind of analysis of life where he's looked at it kind of at the macro level of an organism, a mammal, whatever you got, all the way down to the cellular level and all of the design and components that are functioning together for that cell to do its job. And in his analysis of this, he's noticed a lot of organization, more so than even our own human inventions, right? Cars, computers, whatever you think of, right? And the reason I'm even bringing this up, because like I said earlier, we're a church that's all about Jesus, is because Jesus, who is the author of life, is also the one who founded the church as an organism. And in the Bible, some people say this is Paul's favorite analogy. It's his most frequent one, but you can do something a lot that you don't like, so I'm not going to assume that it's his favorite. But in his most frequent analogy, he compares the followers of Jesus, the believers in Jesus, to a body, right? The church, and I'm not talking about the building or even just our local church, but the church is described as the body of Christ, where every person is a member of that body or a component of that body that results in that working together to accomplish the overall mission of the church, which we've summarized here as to make mature and mobilize disciples, right? Jesus said to go into all the world and preach the gospel. So that's what we do. And since the Bible talks about this analogy, comparing the body of Christ, the church, right, to a physical body, I think it's interesting that at further analysis of living organisms, the same author of both things, we can gain a better understanding as to what that analogy means. So when I'm talking about the body of Christ, I want us to think about every one of us having an important role to play, not necessarily because, you know, some parts of the body might have different degrees of visibility, but they are all necessary for the overall function. And so just like in a living organism, in a church, which I'm talking about like the global church, all followers of Jesus, you couldn't necessarily like pinpoint them all in, you know, this denomination or this group or this building. That's not how it works. It's anyone who's trusted in Jesus is a part of that family of God, is a part of that body, and is working towards, hopefully, that overall function. Okay, so that's what I want us to just kind of think about. This idea is that all their parts formed and knitted together in unison within the whole. And that's the way Jesus designed the church, and that's also the way he engineered life to begin with. Okay, so now to the Bible. We're going to open up in Ephesians chapter 4. I've got some Bibles kicking around. You can also open it up on your phone or tablet if you'd like. Ephesians 4 is kind of like it's probably like the back 5/6 of the Bible. That's probably not a fraction that helps anyone. I don't know. But there we go. I didn't find the page number either. Robin will tell you, just tap her on the shoulder and she doesn't even have one of those Bibles anymore. That's fine. So here we go. I also will have it up on the screen. So Ephesians chapter 4. Check this out. And keep in mind this idea of the entire body working together. It says, and he, that is Jesus, if you don't believe me, you can just read a little earlier and you can prove that for yourself. Jesus gave, so these are gifts that Jesus gave, okay, and this is some of the things that Jesus gave the church. He said he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers for the purpose of, okay, to equip the saints. And you might not describe yourself as very saintly at times, but once you've trusted in Christ for forgiveness, you are the righteousness of God in Christ. Okay, so that word saint applies to you. It doesn't just apply to like people that did cool things in the past for God. It applies to you the moment you follow Jesus, okay? So the purpose of these gifts that God gave, these people, these roles that God gave, is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, okay? So the leadership is designed to build up and equip, and the entire body is functioning together for that body to be built. And it says, verse 13, until we all attain the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God to mature manhood to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Okay, lots of big vocabulary there. So let's pause there for a minute. Go back to verse 11, actually, if you could, Jack. So Jesus gave these gifts, and it wasn't his goal just to like set up some like authoritarian structure of like this is how the church is governed sort of thing. So don't think about it like that, because Jesus made it clear that when it comes to authority, there is great accountability, and in the kingdom of God, any sort of authority, any sort of person that has responsibility, it is used for the sake of serving others. All right, Jesus said that the greatest in the kingdom of heaven has to become the servant of all. So it's a type of servant leadership. So don't think he was setting up something like that. And Jesus gave these things because these are good things for us. These are gifts to the church. Okay, and so some people refer to this as the fivefold ministry. I want to point out that not 100% of followers of Jesus fit into one of these categories. These are, you know, kind of like leadership roles in a sense. But yeah, the idea of the apostles, where apostle literally means sent one. Sometimes people think of church planters or missionaries to a degree in that capacity. There's the literal, like, kind of 12 apostles in the early church. Those are the ones that actually were with Jesus and were authors of scripture as a result. But apostolic ministry is just kind of anyone that's kind of out starting new works, starting new churches, beginning new organizations. The prophets, those are the ones that edify, exhort, and comfort the body of Christ with the word of God, right? They might have operate in some additional parts of the gifts of the Spirit, which you can read about in 1 Corinthians 12 and 14, where, right, they're going to be able to encourage and kind of help guide and steer and avoid some pitfalls that the church might encounter. There's the evangelists. Those are the ones that are gifted in going out and reaching new people that have never heard of Jesus with the gospel, with the good news. So that doesn't mean necessarily distant, like in the missionary sense. It could be entirely local, where you're connecting with new parts of your local community, where you work, where you go to school, who you live next to, and you're bringing Jesus to them, that someone's gifted in that area. And then sometimes people group shepherd teachers together. You could do that. I think that's fine. But when you hear shepherd, some translations use the word pastor. And the idea is that a shepherd is someone that's there to kind of care for and guide our souls and our heart. Hebrews, I think, 13 talks about that Jesus is kind of like the over shepherd. He's like in charge of everything. Jesus referred to himself as the good shepherd, but he also gave shepherds in our lives to care for us so that we don't kind of fall into deception or following our own desires away from the word of God. And then there's teachers. That's kind of where I tend to more lean into, is being able to convey and speak and proclaim the word of God and just being able to hopefully communicate in a way that makes sense. That's my goal. Maybe I've been missing that completely for 2 years. I don't know. But the good thing about our church family is, even though I'm weak in, I think, a good number of those areas, we have a plurality of gifts here. We have a variety of leadership here, so that where I'm weak, others are able to be more talented and are able to keep our local church safer as a result, right? That we are able to be a healthier church because of that. But the purpose for these leaders is for the equipping of the saints. I'm going to attribute this to Dan Kehoe because I heard him say it. I don't know if he was quoting someone else. But he said, leadership is all about equipping the body. Okay, it's all about equipping other believers. So leadership isn't for the sake of leaders feeling important. Romans 13 says that if you have strength is meant for serving others. It's not meant for the sake of making ourselves feel better about, right, doing good things or whatever the case may be. So leadership is about serving and equipping others so that they can then accomplish what God's called them to do. And in this passage, it says that this is Jesus's plan for the church until a certain point. There's a deadline on this, okay? That you should be a part of a church family in your local community until we all attain, this is verse 13, the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God to mature manhood to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So this is Jesus's perpetual plan for you to be equipped for the things you need to do that he's called you to do in this life. And that plan is to continue until we're all mature to, like, the degree that Jesus was mature, right? So that we all kind of measure up to that. And just so you know, that hasn't happened yet, okay? So that would suggest that these gifts are meant to equip you for you to be able to build one another up and all of us building one another up until we meet Jesus. Like, this is his main means to have good works done on the earth, for the gospel to go forth, for his kingdom to be proclaimed, for people to experience freedom and liberty in Christ, to encounter the love of God. It's done through the church. And so that's what it's perpetually his plan. It's not like you graduate church in your life, okay? It's not like, well, yeah, I figured it out. I guess I'm done, right? Like, I kind of move on with my life. Like, no, this is God's plan for you continually. You don't just kind of check out once you are equipped to your own level of satisfaction, right? It's not like, well, I think I've got enough Jesus, like I'm good, right? Like, no, like we need to continue to grow in the knowledge of God. And verse 14 kind of expounds on that idea. So now I'm finally allowing them to click forward. It says, so that we may no longer be children. Okay, so once we trust in Christ for forgiveness, we're adopted into his family, we become children of God. Jesus says that he wants us to have childlike faith, but he doesn't want us to be childish in our behavior. So he does want us to mature as believers, that we're no longer just kind of having all of these crazy, finicky, you know, flaky attitudes and, you know, just going after whatever we're feeling in the moment. And it kind of describes that right here. It says, you know, no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness in deceitful schemes. So there is safety in the church that protects us from believing lies, is essentially what he's saying. The purpose of leadership is for them to convey the word of God, not just our own opinions or ideas, to teach in a way that we're safe, that we'll recognize false teaching when we encounter it. We'll recognize our own desires lying to us when we experience that. That we're not going to just fall prey to whatever new, you know, super cool idea is coming through culture or the church, as far as like, wow, that's a really cool new idea or way to think about Jesus. I'm just going to like get carried away with that. And then another thing comes along and I get carried away with that. The goal is that, you know, God is keeping us core on his word, that we're being safe in that realm. So that's another benefit of the church family. And then he contrasts that in verse 15. He says, rather, so this is what we should be doing. This is what maturity looks like. This is the growth that we're hopefully striving towards and will one day hopefully attain, right, is that we would be speaking the truth in love, okay? We are to grow up. Let's see, I'm just going to emphasize that. Grow up, all right? There we go. I mean, ow, man, what? Come on. Grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. So there's that analogy. We are part of the body and Jesus is the head. That's where the plan comes from. That's where the signals come from. That's where we get our orders from. Jesus is in charge and we are supposed to grow up in every way into him. And then it says, verse 16, from whom, so Jesus is the source, the sustenance, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. And so notice the parallel concept here between Douglas Axe's quote about his observations of life and how it's just this entire unity of the organism at every level. Everything's working towards the common cause and overall goals of that organism. And likewise, we see Paul describing the church in this way, that we are equipped by every joint in the church, that every member, every part of the body working together results in my being equipped. That apart from the body of Christ, I will be ill-equipped for the things that God's called me to do. That there's a need, not just for someone to make coffee in the morning, but there's a need for you specifically as an individual. Not that we just need you to make the coffee, but we need you in the body of Christ in order for us to grow as an organism in the way that God's designed it, right? That there's significance, there's importance in every person, that I want to let you know, we need you. And the Bible suggests that you need us, right? That I need the entire body and the entire body needs me, that there's this interconnected whole in the way that God has designed his church family. All right, so I don't want you to ever think that like you are not needed in the body of Christ. And so when I think about that, I don't want you to veer towards, well, I guess they need someone to clean the church, or they need someone to be a greeter, or they need someone to watch the kids. Don't just think in those contexts regarding the needs that we have to make our weekend gathering happen. okay? Because we can do church without those things, all right? Like, we can just do church if all of us just get together, like, at a house or in our yard, and just, like, we can worship Jesus and talk about the Bible and seek God without those things. Those things do allow us to be more welcoming, obviously, which we want to welcome people in as Jesus welcomed us into his kingdom, all right? Those are valuable things. That those are areas where we can learn to serve. But when I talk about your need in the body, the Bible doesn't talk about, like, you know, people being gifted by the Holy Spirit to straighten chairs, okay? Like, that's not the types of gifts that the Bible talks about. But it's oftentimes in doing those very practical things that God develops our character, and we even might find our gifts. Okay, so that's what I want to point out. Your giftings are not only like, well, we really could use someone to vacuum this stage. Like, that's not why you're needed. That's helpful. That's very practical. But you are gifted beyond that. All right. And on the back of the bonus content, on the handout you've got there, I've got some ideas of, like, just general things that all believers should be working towards. And then also some, like, practical things that if you're looking for a way to serve in the church that you could be a part of. Okay, but, like, Jesus didn't start the church so that we could have really straight chairs in an auditorium. Okay, like, that wasn't his, like, vision for the church. The vision was that the word of God would be preached, that the body would grow, we'd have this interdependency on one another, we'd stir each other up towards good works, that we'd be able to pray for one another, we'd encourage each other, that we'd actually accomplish the mission. Okay, so some of these things are, like, secondary and helpful, but the reason you're needed is because who knows what word of encouragement you might offer to someone today at the end of the gathering, right? Who knows that whether God's called you to pray for someone and he's going to heal them today at the gathering, right? And just the fact that we can gather together and worship God together rather than just, you know, we're not forced to be just in our own little prayer closet all the time, although we should do that. But we get to gather together and be encouraged together as we serve and worship God in unity. So don't just think about, like, when I'm saying, like, serving or being a part of the church or fulfilling your role, that I'm just, like, looking for people to help out, okay, on a weekend event. Because we would fail as a church if the only thing we ever did was a weekend gathering, okay? We would fail as a church if we just got so good at this that we didn't even need God. Right, where we're just like, yeah, we're really good at getting together, we can play music, we can read things, and then we're good. Like, we've got this figured out. We don't even need the Holy Spirit anymore. We would fail as a church if that was the case. So we've got to take a look. We're going to do a case study in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 6, so you can turn there. That'll be to the left a few pages. And we're going to take a look at the early church in this moment that they experienced where there's this kind of issue that happens, and we'll see the way that leadership responds and the church family responds and how God results in the overall growth of the church. And so this is an actual event. So in Acts chapter 6, we see this, verse 1. Now, in those days, or in these days rather, when the disciples were increasing in number, it sounds like a good problem. All right, right? Like, God wants the church to be growing. A complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. It's talking about food that was unjustly being distributed, that the Jewish followers of Jesus, those widows, were being cared for in priority over the Greek-speaking widows that were in the church. So there's a problem. There's an issue of injustice. This complaint arises, and this is the sort of thing where, like, the early church almost had the first church split, right? Like, this is an issue. Like, uh-oh, like, what do we do? Like, this is an important thing. We want to make sure that we handle the resources of the church justly. We don't want to, you know, neglect or reject people on the basis of their, right, in this case, the language that they spoke or their nationality or their heritage. And so here's this issue. And verse 2, let's see. And the 12 summoned the full number of the disciples. So the 12 is referring to, like, the 12 apostles. And so they called everyone together. And notice this. So this is the decision of leadership that was pivotal in the history of the church. If they chose this wrong, chances are we wouldn't be here now. Okay? This is what they said. It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. All right, so the point is this. It's good and important that widows are cared for well. It's good and important for the church to take care of those needs, and we should be doing that. But what's of more importance than even feeding people is that the word of God is being preached. Right? Like, one of those things could happen and we would just be a really good restaurant or a food pantry or like a soup kitchen, but we wouldn't be a church anymore. Okay? And that if the early church, if the leadership of the church was like, oh man, like we just got to start like running around and solving all these little problems, they would cease to have been effective at what God's called them to do. So it's not that they were refusing to like serve people. Like, no, I think I'm above this. Like, we'll let someone else solve this problem. It was that there was a more significant service, a priority of what had to be done, which was preaching the word of God. So they weren't saying like starving widows aren't that important. They're saying it is important, but we need to make sure that the priority is in the right order. Okay, I guess to make that point, I'll say this. You could feed a person and meet their physical need temporarily here on the earth, but preaching the word of God will meet their spiritual need, bringing them to new life that is eternally valuable both here on the earth and in heaven. Okay, so like that's why like this is more important than just feeding people. Okay, although feeding people is something that the church should be about. Okay, that is something we should be doing. Okay, so verse 3, here's their solution. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to ministry, the ministry of the word. So once again, that priority is being demonstrated. We really need to make sure that as a church, we're preaching the word of God, that prayer is being lifted up, that these are the things that matter most that make us unique from a restaurant, okay? So let's see, verse 5, and this is the biggest miracle, and what they said pleased the whole gathering. Wow, like that is amazing. Like I don't think that's ever happened since, where like a decision from any group has had 100% like unanimity. I'm not gifted in that, I guess. It's okay. All right. Wow. Yeah, my face is a little red there. Everybody liked it. There we go. I pronounced it right that time. Whew. We're having fun today. And let's see. And it pleased the whole gathering. And they chose, and now they list off some of these folks, Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. They set before the apostles, and they prayed and laid hands on them. So that's just kind of like appointing these guys publicly. And check this out. What was the result of their decision? What was the result of these folks being willing to serve in this way? This is what we'd want. And the word of God continued to increase, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. So we'll pause there. So check this out. So the leadership made the priority that which was most important, which was the word of God going forth. Right? Jesus said, preach the gospel to all nations. So that's the priority. And they delegated this also significant issue, this thing that mattered a lot, making sure that there were matters of justice being tended to and that food was being distributed properly. They delegated this, and it was in an area of serving the body. This was a very practical need that had to be fulfilled, right? It was just like, we need someone to like pass out food, right? That's not like, you're not going to see something in the Bible that says, like, this is what God called you to do sort of thing. That wasn't the mission of the church. But it was a very practical need that needed to be met. And they didn't get distracted. They didn't get sidetracked from the overall goal. It would have been sad if the church resulted in, what if it said, like, you know, and the disciples got distracted with having to solve all these problems within the church, that there were offenses always going on, and they're running around trying to put out these fires. And what if it said, and the word of God decreased, the number of people who were changed by the word of God was less, and not many people were changed in their community, and no one was obedient to the faith. Like, that would have been devastating, and like I said, you and I wouldn't be here today if they didn't put in right priority the Word of God. So the Bible is the thing that makes us unique. The gospel, the good news about Jesus, is the thing that produces change and life in us. So that's what we emphasize. And last week, we even talked about the idea of doing good works, that they would be seen by men, that they would glorify our Father in heaven. The purpose of our going out and demonstrating God's love is to hopefully point people to God, that we would be showing them his love so that they would encounter him and experience the change that God wants to bring about in their lives, right? So that's even one of the reasons we talked about, right, good works. It's to point them to Jesus. And notice, so that even though this, you might think of like, oh, passing out food, like, I don't know, most anyone could do that. But it seems as though the church had like a pretty high standard for those who they chose to do this task, even though it's a really practical task. Although, you might even think like, well, that's like kind of a menial task, but they actually held it with super high regard. They made sure that those who were doing it were going to meet pretty high qualifications. And so of the things they listed, they said that this person had to have good repute or good reputation, okay? That they didn't just want anybody being like, oh, all right, we'll make that guy pass out the food to the widows. But then in the community, what if that person's known to be like a sleazy business owner that kind of like cheats and deceives people? You don't want that person being the one that's managing church resources. That's kind of not good for things. You want someone with a good reputation. And we see that God is actually often more interested in our character and our integrity than he is our own ability. That God's like, I can solve the ability problem. Like, I just need someone who's willing to be humble, who's willing to, right, work through their character defects. That's someone that I need. And throughout the Bible, we see cases of people who are incredibly talented that have character defects that completely miss out on the plan that God has, right? So it's not an emphasis on we just need to find the most talented people. God's interested in finding people who the Holy Spirit has already begun working in their hearts and is producing change, right? That's what God is interested in. And so even in the Bible, in Titus chapter 1 and 1 Timothy 3, it talks about qualifications for elders, okay? Like those who are the shepherds and the pastors of a church. And in that list, it does like further down on the list say like, oh yeah, like a pastor should be able to teach. But what's interesting is that is like in the middle of the list, among many different qualifications required for a pastor, where most of those things have to do with their integrity, their character, their family life, right? The way they treat people, the way they are looked at out in the community, right? So God is more interested in our character and integrity than he is even our ability, right? He's like, yeah, oh yeah, they should probably also be able to teach. But I mean, even in that case, just like sidetrack right now, I'm thinking of even Moses, who was like, God, I think you've got the wrong guy. Like, I am not good at public speaking. I can't pronounce unanimity, right? Like, how am I going to go talk to Pharaoh to tell him to let the people go, right? Like, I can't do this. And God's like, no, don't worry about it. Like, that's fine. You're good, right? So I just want to point out, God is less interested in your ability than he is your character. And oftentimes, even through doing something that might seem like a very practical need of serving someone else, God is interested in changing our hearts, right? Like, because I mean, if God just wanted to, he could just like every, you know, Sunday afternoon, he could just like, you know, speak and like suddenly like our church chairs all get straightened out, the whole building gets swept up, like everything gets taken care of. Like he could just like speak and bam, like the slides would advance on their own, right? These instruments would just start playing on their own. Like God could just create things if he wanted to. He chooses to include us in participating in these ways, partly to develop our character. Okay, so when it comes to someone of good reputation, that means like in selecting these people, even for fulfilling this very practical task of distributing food, they needed someone who was like a Christian who didn't have like some, you know, super apparent like unrepentant sin that the community would have been aware of. They can't have a reputation that the community's like, I don't know why they're letting that person be involved in this way. Like this is a concern, right? We shouldn't let someone who's known in the community to be a thief to be in charge of like the offering or something like that. Like, That would be a concern. So we need to have someone of good reputation. They also, in the list, said that they need to be full of the Spirit. Okay? So they need to have been changed by God. They need to have experienced, like, rejuvenation of the Holy Spirit, that they've been born again, that they are having fruit of the Spirit on display in their life, that maybe even some gifts of the Spirit are already in operation. Some churches are, like, super specific, saying, like, oh, you need to have certain gifts. I don't think that's the case, but, like, we want to start, like, moving towards being yielded to the Holy Spirit in the way that He wants to empower us and work through us. So that's what they were looking for. They also needed someone who was full of wisdom. And this doesn't just mean, like, street smarts, that, like, you know, you've figured this out, you've got this worldly wisdom thing down, because, like, the Bible says, like, you know, God chooses the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. That worldly wisdom in some ways is even demonic, I think it says in James. And so, like, this isn't what he's talking about. He's talking about, we want people with wisdom who know the wisdom of God, that they have the word of God, that they know how to apply God's word in the situations they encounter, as, yes, even as they're passing out food to widows. That they'll be able to, whenever they encounter this problem or a suffering or a need, that they'll be able to speak hope and wise counsel into that person's life. So they needed someone that was full of wisdom, that was biblically wise. And then it was of these people that then the apostles appointed to do this work, right? So they had to meet all of these qualifications. And I don't want us to think, like, well, I don't meet that one. Or, no, I don't got that one down either. Like, I guess this is good. That means I don't have to do the assignment, right? Like, I can just, like, not do it because I'm not qualified, so I don't have to serve. Like, this sounds pretty good. But I want to point out, like, don't be content in not growing in those areas as a means to just be like, well, I guess this means I don't have to serve. This is something that you would want, because it would be a sad thing to live a life that's unfruitful by the standard to which God called you to live, right? Like, we can do a lot in this life, but if it's not the things that God's called us to do, it would be unfortunate when we get into heaven and we're like, oh, I was completely distracted. Like, I didn't do the thing that you told me to, right? So we want you to continue to grow in these areas, be encouraged, be equipped, right? Be held accountable, be, right, growing with one another so that you hopefully could meet some of those qualifications, right? That then you could then be more easily used in the kingdom of God in producing change in this world, right? In doing the good works that He's called you to do. So part of our equipping comes from being given opportunities to serve, okay? Part of our equipping comes from our being given opportunities to serve, and our equipping is for the purpose of serving. So it's just kind of like this feedback loop. We're just, like, you know, growing and developing in our gifts and in our character, and then that's going back towards the body of Christ growing as an organism, making us more and more effective. And check this out. This is so cool. Acts 6:8. Put that up on the screen. So here they look at one of these guys, Stephen. And it says, "And Stephen, full of grace and power, was doing great wonders and signs among the people." So as Stephen is going around doing this very practical service to meet the needs of other people, the Holy Spirit empowers him to do supernatural things in their lives. Where he, like, I imagine, like, he's praying for people and they're getting healed, right? He's able to, like, maybe have words of knowledge, and he's just, like, speaking wisdom and truth into their lives. That Stephen's going around and, like, he's like, I was just here to, like, deliver your bread, but, like, then suddenly God is showing up and working through him, doing amazing, supernatural, cool gifts through his life. Like, that's pretty cool in my mind. And I just want to point out, there's a principle in the Bible that those who can be trusted with little can be trusted with much. And so, like, if Stephen was like, no, you know, I think I'm just called to just, like, I think I've got a gift of healing. I'm not interested in passing out food to widows. Like, that's not what God's called me to do. I'm going to turn that one down. I really don't want to do it anyway, right? Like, that he would have missed out on these opportunities. That oftentimes God will give you, and you will discover the spiritual giftings you have while you're doing very practical things in service towards others, right? So like, Stephen would have missed out on all of these opportunities if he was like, nah, that's not for me. I'm good. Like, I don't think I need to do that. So if God's called you to be a missionary or a pastor or whatever he's called you to do, don't reject other opportunities because you don't think they fit in the box of the job description you want to have someday. Okay, don't reject those opportunities because God might be more interested, like I said, in developing your character so that when the time comes, you're equipped for that bigger task, that bigger goal that you want to have in your future. So don't turn down those opportunities. So Stephen ends up discovering all of these giftings while he's doing a very simple, practical task, right? So you don't want to turn down those opportunities. And I'll let you read the rest of that on your own, but Stephen ends up being just like really bold in his faith, where like he's doing these miracles. They're probably telling their neighbors, and the next time he comes around with bread, they're like, oh man, my neighbor's here too. She wants you to pray for her. And like, he's like, oh no, it's not even me. It's Jesus in me. Let me tell you about Jesus. And he's just like bold in preaching the gospel and being willing to share the truth. And it upsets religious leaders in that community so much so that they actually like kind of haul him out into the streets and like accuse him of blasphemy. And they end up killing him with rocks by throwing rocks at him repeatedly until he dies. So I would just like to suggest that doing good works, even if it kills you, is worth it. Okay? Because I don't think Stephen, I think Stephen's in heaven, but I don't think Stephen's in heaven right now like, oh man, I should have just like laid off on the Jesus stuff, like just a little bit. Like if only I'd compromised a little bit, I might have been able to live like, imagine what 20 years more of my life could have looked like, what I could have done. Like I don't think he's regretting his decision that he made. He is like eternally rejoicing and experiencing the reward of his obedience to Jesus. Okay, like he still would have been saved because he's trusted Jesus. We're, once again, just to make that clear, we're not saved by our good works. Jesus did all of the work for us. We just trust in him. But once we're saved, we start living for Jesus. And yeah, for some reason, God even rewards us for those things that we do that are empowered by him, that are led by him, that were planned out for him, you know, for us to do by him. So even if doing good works gets you killed, it's still worth it. You won't regret it, okay? So that happened to Stephen. So I share this story. I look at this kind of thing that the Bible talks about in terms of this relationship with the body of Christ and the way that Jesus has organized it and the way that he's given us gifts in different leaders that he brings along in our lives and the way that we are built up in one another. And I want us to think about, as a church, what does that mean for us? Okay, because this is globally true for the body of Christ, but what does that mean for Valley Town Church? Because right now, like, we're 4.5 years old, and we're coming up to another one of these defining moments for our church, where I am working full-time out of the church as a math teacher in less than a month. And what's that going to mean for our church family? Now, I this is a potential problem, but I actually think this is a huge opportunity. Like, this is really encouraging to me because this means perpetual sustaining of our church, that we as a church plant will continue to survive and thrive in this area. I think this is going to mean, like, huge opportunity as far as we as a body growing together and discovering our gifts as we're able to serve. But I want to make sure that we as a church, that this isn't somehow like a turning point, where what if, like, if the Bible documented the history of our church, what if this was a moment where it's like, and then the word of God decreased? Right? And people weren't encountered with Jesus and lives weren't being changed. Like, I don't want that to be this moment. I don't want that to be the history of our church. So I want us to think about, what does this look like for us? Right? And that as this next month and this fall is coming up, like, what is it going to look like for our church family? And what areas do we all need to be knitted together, growing and encouraging one another and accomplishing the good works that God's called us to do? And some of those things, yeah, like, as I'm, like, you know, going to only be part-time here, there's going to be a lot of, like, very practical tasks that need to get done that aren't necessarily in anyone's, like, gifted area that they've been called to. Like, I'm just really passionate about, like, sweeping floors. Like, I don't know. But there's things that will need to get done that we're going to have to decide. Like, okay, how are we as a church family going to step up to continue to reach out in our community, to continue to be interested in spreading our resources to plant new churches? What are we going to do as a church family? Right? Like, so this is kind of like up to us now. Like, what will we do? Are we each going to fulfill our part? Because a living organism like Douglas Axe was talking about has all of these components working together for the overall objective of the whole. Okay? And with the advice of my wife, I didn't do this, but I had a chicken die this week, and I was thinking of just like bringing it in here in a plastic bag to make this point, but I didn't. It's not hiding in here anywhere, I assure you. Okay? But there are a lot more ways for a chicken to die than there are for it to continue living. All right? Like, if any one of its components fail, it dies pretty quickly. All right? So, like, whether that's the raccoon that, like, bit it around the neck area, like, and it died, that's one of the ways a chicken can die. All right? And so, like, there are a lot of ways that as a church, as an organism, we could die when any one of our components ceases to function. All right, so like I just want us to think about that. Like, there are a lot of ways that we could fail. In the Bible, one of the ways that it warns us is just in terms of offense, like in terms of our ability to be united together. Okay, that in Titus 3, I didn't get to it last week. I mentioned it on the bonus content, though. Just like the idea that the greatest challenges that face the body of Christ is not the difficulty of the mission, but whether or not we can walk together in unity. And so, like, one of the issues as a church, like, how are we going to continue to deal with issues of offense that are going to just pop up between one another just because that naturally happens because we're people? Like, are we going to be perpetual forgivers of one another and just repenters towards one another? Are we going to be able to just continue to work through that we don't get distracted by all of these little things and then not accomplish the mission that God's called us to do? All right? So, like, I want to let you know, you are needed in this church family, all right? And even if you're called somewhere else, even if, like, you're heading off to a different career path, you're going off to college, you are needed in the next month or whatever in this church family, and you will be needed somewhere else. And wherever you find yourself, because I don't think I'm always going to be everyone's pastor here, you're going to move around all over this globe, wherever you find yourself, plug into the body of Christ. And I hope that the season you are here with us, that we are able to effectively equip you for what God's called you to do. So let's see. So as the worship team comes back up, we'll get those guys back up here. Like I said, we've got communion today. And communion is something where Jesus, he started it the night before he died. Actually, you might even be able to link it back to Genesis 18 when Melchizedek shows up and hangs out with Abraham. It might have been Jesus showing up. I'll let you, never mind, I'm getting off track. But communion is about the idea that Jesus offered his body to be broken on the cross, that he shed his blood that we could be forgiven of our sins, that he paid the price, the penalty that we deserved so that we could be saved. Okay? And he invites us into experiencing the life that he offers. Okay, so he said, right, he said, like, to take this bread, which is my body, right, to drink this cup, which is my blood. And communion is not just about our relationship with Christ, but communion is also about our relationship together as the body of Christ, right? I can't remember where the verse is, but Paul says that just as there is one bread, there is one body. So this is about unity with us as well as unity with Christ as individuals. So if you have trusted Jesus for the fact that he broke his body and shed his blood and died and rose again for you, that's something that you can partake in, right? This is something that we do in celebration. It's not even something we do in, like, kind of like somber remembrance, okay? Because Jesus is resurrected. He's alive forevermore. So don't just think like, man, it sure would be great if Jesus was still around. Like, Jesus is alive and he's reigning over the universe. And he invites you into relationship with him. Okay, so I just want to point out, like, this is something that we can celebrate. George, you got something?
Yeah, the Lord impressed upon my heart during this thing that, for me, but it's for everybody, our lives are hidden in Christ. The Father sees Jesus. This doesn't give us, you know, individual by an evil one, that the women are working through the church because, the eyes are out of it. You kind of let yourself develop. You know, if we're a diamond in the rough, like we'll be worth it.
Amen.
Just remember that, no matter what your past was, live in the now.
Amen. Yeah, and there's no condemnation in Christ. Like he was saying, we're hidden in Christ. When God looks at us, he sees Jesus. We are the righteousness of God in Christ. So we take communion in thankfulness to Jesus and what he did in celebration. And even though he suffered and died to do that, he thought you were worth it to go through that experience. So if you've never trusted Jesus, that's something that you can do today. You don't have to like talk to me. You can if you want. I'll help you. I'll pray for you or whatever. But you can just talk to God and just get your heart right with him to say, God, I turn from my old life, from living my own way, from doing my own thing. I trust in you for forgiveness. I'm sorry for what I've done, and I'm going to follow you from this day forth. And so when your heart is ready, make sure you don't have unforgiveness towards other people. So even if you are a believer, make sure you just get your heart right before God during these last couple songs. You can go find your way over to that, break off a piece of bread, grab a cup, and then whether you want to take it with your family, you want to come back to your seat, you want to find a space in a corner or something to continue to worship God as you partake of it, that's something you can do. So let's just pray real quick. All right, guys, let's see. I'm a little over time. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much, Lord, that you are a forever present help in time of need, that you are with us even to the ends of the age, that, Lord, your spirit dwells in us. We are your temple, that you have brought us to newness of life, and that, God, you don't call us to a life of being alone, but, Lord, you've also brought us into a wonderful family. We are not just adopted into your household, God, but you've also brought us in with many brothers and sisters. And so, Lord, I just thank you for our church family. I thank you that we can continue to be a part of other ministries in India and Africa, and that, Lord, we can just be a part of encouraging and planting churches across this globe. And, Lord, I just ask that you would be at work in each of us. Help us to discover what you've called us to do. Reveal to us the gifts that you're working in us, Holy Spirit, that we can be encouraged by one another, that we can edify one another, that we can accomplish the things that you've called us to do. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.